Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Charles Darwin's Barnacle and David Bowie's Spider, How Scientific Names Celebrate Adventurers, Heroes, and Even a Few Scoundrels, by Stephen B. Hurd, PhD. Narrated by Jonathan Todd Ross. Preface. Part of what makes us human is our curiosity about the world around us. That curiosity drives scientists to discover, describe, and name the millions of other species with which we share our planet. Every now and then, the naming of a newly discovered species catches the public eye. Sometimes it's because that new species is named after a person, be they living or dead, real or imaginary, admired or loathed. Among such eponymous namings are the barnacle named for Charles Darwin, Regio Scalpellum Darwini, the spider named for David Bowie, Heteropoda David Bowie, the fungus named for SpongeBob SquarePants, Spongiforma SquarePantsii, and the beetle named for George W. Bush, Agathidium Bushi. These namings, and many more like them, connect the scientists who name species, the species that bear the names, and the people to whom the names refer. They also strike many people as a little peculiar. What a strange way it seems to pay tribute to someone, to build their name into a quasi-Latin name for a species, a name that will be used primarily by scientists writing technical and jargon-filled journal papers and monographs. You can almost sympathize with Jane Colden's aunt. Jane Colden was likely the New World's first female botanist. She was active in the middle of the 18th century. Her father, the marvelously named Cadwallader Colden, was also a botanist and supported her interest in natural history. Jane's handwritten and hand-drawn manuscript illustrating the flora of New York circulated in London, and it was suggested that a plant should be named Fibroe Coldenella in her honor. Her aunt, however, was shocked and objected. What? Name a weed after a Christian woman? It was Carl Linnaeus, the brilliant 18th century Swedish botanist, who made it possible for a spider to bear David Bowie's name, or for a plant to bear Jane Colden's, and thus for a name to tell a story. Before Linnaeus, the scientific naming of a plant or animal species was simply an exercise in description. A name was a Latin phrase, sometimes quite a long one, that described the species and separated it from similar ones. But it did no more than that. Linnaeus's binomial system was different in several important ways. Most celebrated is that it's simple and allows easy organization of our knowledge about the Earth's biodiversity. Each species has a single word name, coupled with a single word genus name for its group of immediate relatives. Acerrubrum, for example, with rubrum designating one of 130 or so living species of maples in the genus Acer. But a less widely appreciated novelty in Linnaeus's system was its separation of naming from description. Linnaean names, and all scientific or Latin names since Linnaeus, are indexing devices. They may be descriptive, as in Acerrubrum, red maple, but they don't have to be, as in Acer Davidii, Pear David's maple. Linnaeus's invention of nondescriptive names might seem trivial, but it made something possible that had never been possible before. In naming species, scientists could express themselves. In choosing to honor someone with an eponymous Latin name, a scientist can tell a story about the person being honored, but at the same time, that scientist tells a story about him or herself. With Linnaeus's invention, names, and eponymous names in particular, became a window on scientists' personalities. What shows through that window? That scientists aren't the cool, dull, and unemotional creatures that many might expect. They use Latin naming creatively, and in doing so reveal all of humanity's virtues, weaknesses, and foibles. In naming organisms, some scientists proclaim their admiration for naturalists, explorers, and others among their heroes. Some acknowledge their gratitude to their mentors or patrons. Some express their love for their husbands or daughters or parents. Some stake their claims as fans of Harry Potter or of punk music. Some make statements about justice and human rights. Some signal their disdain for demagogues and dictators. Others sadly reveal their approval of them. The eponymous names of organisms can reveal the shame of bias and prejudice, but also the pride we can feel in attempts to rise above those human failings. In coining eponymous names, scientists show themselves as sometimes sober, sometimes playful, and sometimes eccentric, sometimes gracious and sometimes spiteful, and every bit as passionate about history, arts, and culture as they are about the pattern of scales on the belly of a snake. Through the window of eponymous naming, we see the best and the worst of humanity. We see science as a fully human activity, full of personality and history, and shaped by intriguing connections between the species that's named, the person it's named for, and the scientist doing the naming. As Mistress Mouffet puts it in A.S. Byatt's novel, Morpho-Eugenia, names, you know, are a way of weaving the world together. The stories woven by eponymous names can be surprising, fascinating, and poignant. Occasionally, they can be infuriating. The book that follows tells some of those stories. Enjoy your look through the window. Introduction. A lemur and its name. You and I are primates. Our lineage among mammals stretches back 75 million years. In some ways, it hasn't been a terribly successful one. Only 504 living primate species are known to science, compared with, for example, 1,240 species of bats, 26,000 of orchids, and 60,000 of weevils. At the same time, though, it's a lineage that, through the actions of our own species, has transformed the planet as no other ever has. We can be both ashamed and proud of this. It's true that no species has ever polluted so many lakes, raised so many forests, or driven so many other species near or to extinction. But it's also true that no species before us has written symphonies or built libraries or art galleries. Even more, no species has thirsted so much to understand its world, and no species has ever made so much progress toward that goal. Like every species, we have our local preoccupations with territory, food, and mates. But we've also looked up from them to study and name rocks, plants, animals, landforms, even planets and stars. As human beings, we tend to be intensely interested in our own kin. That's true in genealogical and geographic senses. We cherish our families and our local communities. But it's also true in an evolutionary sense. The 19th century discovery of our close relationship to the other great apes sparked a public controversy that continues in some circles today. The primate house is a showpiece attraction at any zoo, and we devour articles and documentary films about chimpanzees, gorillas, and our other close relatives. When I take undergraduate students on field courses to the tropics, nothing excites them more than a chance to glimpse a monkey swinging high in the forest canopy. Surprisingly, perhaps, our knowledge of our primate kin is far from complete. We know quite a lot about chimpanzees, bonobos, gorillas, and orangutans, which are the largest primates and our very closest relatives. We know much less about the rest of the group. A few are both well-studied and staples of popular culture. Think of the Japanese macaques that make such captivating images when they bathe in hot springs in winter. Most others are understood superficially at best. Deep in the forests of Madagascar, for example, live primate species newly recognized by science and virtually unknown. Among these most mysterious of our relatives are the mouse lemurs. There are 24 species of mouse lemurs in Madagascar. All but two were unknown to science just 25 years ago. One of these newly recognized species is the smallest of all living primates, Madam Bertha's mouse lemur. A full-grown adult would fit comfortably in the palm of your hand and weighs just 30 grams, about as much as 5 U.S. quarters or a slice of bread. Madam Bertha's mouse lemurs live only in a small area around the Kirindi forest on Madagascar's western coast. Kirindi is a tropical deciduous forest, sparse and quiet through the long dry season when the trees drop their leaves and much of the fauna hunkers down to wait out the drought. When the rains return, the forest becomes a dense tangle of green and a hive of activity. If you visit Kirindi as the rainy season begins, around dusk you might feel a breeze hint at relief from the day's heat while the last traces of sunset pink fade in the western sky. Stay still for a while and you may hear rustling in the branches, and perhaps a soft chittering call. Mouse lemurs are emerging from their daytime tree hole nests to forage in the forest understory for fruits, tree sap, and insect honeydew. A well-aimed flashlight may catch some pairs of curious eyes, reflecting a softly gleaming orange. The smallest pair of those eyes belongs to our smallest of kin. We've known for a long time that mouse lemurs live in Kirindi Forest. Only in the mid-1990s, though, did scientists realize that Kirindi mouse lemurs were not one but two species. The larger one, the gray mouse lemur, has been known to science since the 18th century. But the smaller, Madam Bertha's mouse lemur, was formally recognized and described by scientists only in 2001. In the process, it received a formal, Latin or scientific, name, Microcebus berthi. That name, it turns out, honors a woman named Bertha Rokoto Samimanana. Who was Bertha Rokoto Samimanana? How did the tiniest of all our relatives come to bear her name? What did she do to deserve this tribute? For a tribute it is. An odd kind of tribute, it might seem to many, but a heartfelt tribute nonetheless. Everyone knows that science can be dull and fusty, and that the Latin names we give to plants and animals are the dullest and fustiest of all. They're long, they're unmemorable and unpronounceable, and they're, at best, a necessary evil that biology students memorize as some kind of scientific hazing ritual. Everyone knows this, but everyone is wrong. Sure, some Latin names are difficult or obscure, but others are marvels. In the book that follows, I'll share with you the stories that lie behind Latin names honoring people. Explorers, naturalists, adventurers, even politicians and artists and pop singers. These stories are a window on the culture of science and the personality of scientists, and they reveal fascinating connections between the scientists who name species, the people they honor in the naming, and the organisms that bear the names. We'll return to the story of Bertha Rokoto Samimanana and her mouse lemur in the epilogue. But in the meantime, there are plenty more to tell. Chapter 1. The Need for Names. "What's the use of their having names," the gnats said, "if they won't answer to them?" "No use to them," said Alice, "but it's useful to the people that name them, I suppose." Lewis Carroll through the looking glass. Our planet teems with life. Tropical rainforests and coral reefs are staples of documentary filmmaking, in part because they offer astonishing biodiversity. Wherever you turn, a new and different species comes into view. A football field-sized piece of Amazonian rainforest might have 200 different species of trees, and that's just the trees, which are far surpassed in diversity by herbaceous plants, by insects, by fungi, by mites, and by members of many other groups. Visit an Indonesian rainforest, or even just a different tract of Amazonian forest, and you'll find different species. Leave the rainforest for a dry forest or a cloud forest or a savanna, and you'll find different species again. This pattern continues as you travel the globe. Some habitats are richer in life than others, but all add to the tally of species on Earth. Even habitats that seem utterly hostile to life have their denizens. Boiling hot springs, the deepest caves, the snowfields of the Himalayas, cracks in rocks a kilometer underground. How many species share our planet? For biologists, it's both exciting and professionally embarrassing that we don't know. We don't even have a particularly good guess, or rather, we have a lot of guesses, but they don't narrow the range much. We do know that it's a lot. Somewhere around 1.5 million species have been formally described and named by science. Most estimates of the total number of Earth's living species are somewhere between 3 million and 100 million. A recent estimate of a trillion species just of bacteria and other microbes raised a lot of eyebrows. Although that number's plausibility has been hotly debated, its publication makes it obvious that we can't put a clear limit on how high the count could go. But each of these estimates counts only living species. Over the 4 billion-year history of life on Earth, far more species once lived but are now extinct. And this fact makes the planet's biodiversity even more astonishing. If extinction has claimed 99% of all species that have ever lived, itself a guess with the real fraction most likely higher, then all-time species counts are two orders of magnitude higher than our counts of species alive today. 300 million, 10 billion, 100 trillion? Each is or was a distinct species with its own morphology, behavior, habitat preferences and requirements, and ecology. This is mind-boggling, wonderful, and something of a problem. Why do I say Earth's diversity is something of a problem? Because all of these species need names. They need names for psychological reasons, and they need names for practical ones. Psychologically, naming gives us comfort with the existence of Earth's species and allows us to make progress thinking about them. Actually, this is true not just of living organisms, but all the other kinds of entities we name. The brilliant French mathematician Alexandre Grothendieck, for example, wrote that, "One of my passions has been to give names to mathematical concepts as they reveal themselves to me, as a first step in understanding them." Grothendieck was well known for the care he took in naming new concepts or mathematical objects, in ways that brought attention to them and shaped the way people thought about them. Something similar was involved in Georg Cantor's discovery that some infinite sets are larger than others. In particular, some are infinite but countable, while others are uncountable. Cantor gave these different sizes of infinities names, assigning them what we call Aleph numbers. By naming infinities, Cantor, in an important sense, made them accessible to mathematicians and to further mathematical thought. And in doing so, he sparked a storm of mathematical controversy. What's true for abstract mathematical concepts is no less true of concrete things. It just feels natural to talk about something that's named but difficult, and vaguely discomforting to talk about something that's merely described. Naming seems to be deeply seated in who we are as a species. In the Old Testament creation story, naming Earth's creatures was Adam's first job. "And out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air, and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof." Genesis chapter 2, verse 19. King James Version. For good or bad, naming may even make us feel like we have some power over the things we name. From Egyptian and Norse mythology to Rumpelstiltskin to A Wizard of Earthsea, our stories touch on naming and power in naming over and over again. Even in the absence of our psychological compulsion to name, though, the practical need for names would dictate that we do so. That's because we need to keep track of our planet's millions of species. We need to be able to talk about them and to know which one we're talking about unambiguously among all of the millions of possibilities. After all, the red berries are good to eat, but the blue ones are poisonous, breaks down pretty quickly in a world as diverse as ours. If legislation prohibits development of the habitat used by a species that's at risk of extinction, both developers and conservationists want to be sure that we all agree on which species that is, so we can identify those off-limits habitats with precision. If we've discovered a promising new cancer drug in a deep-sea sponge, we need to be able to tell each other which sponge it is, so that we can all be testing the same extract. If a child has been poisoned by a mushroom, we need to be able to tell doctors which one. And those doctors need to be able to look up symptoms and treatments for that precise mushroom. Naming solves the keeping track problem. Each distinct entity to be kept track of gets a name, and that name works both as a label by which we refer to the entity and as an indexing mechanism by which we tie the entity to the knowledge we have about it. We use names to keep track of the children in our families, the minerals in Earth's crust, automobile models in showrooms, and listings on the stock exchange. We do this with living species, too. We name grizzly bears and polar bears and spectacled bears and panda bears, coho salmon and Chinook salmon and king salmon, tulips and geraniums and daffodils. Grizzly bear, coho salmon, and daffodil are examples of common names, the names we use routinely in everyday conversation. Common names can be fascinating and evocative, with origins in description, the fork-tailed swallow from an Old English word for a cleft stick, onomatopoeia, rook, folklore, goat sucker, and even eponymy, Darwin's finches. But for a variety of reasons, they fall far short of doing the job we need naming to do. For one thing, not infrequently, common names are inaccurate. Darwin's finches aren't finches, African violets aren't violets, and electric eels aren't eels. Much worse, there are too many common names, and also not nearly enough. There are too many in that a single creature may bear many common names. For example, a single New World wildcat has at least 40 different English names. Cougar, puma, catamount, panther, painter, mountain screamer, mountain lion, and many more. Those are just its English names, though. It also has names in French and Spanish and Portuguese, Nuchanal and Quechi, and Urarina, and dozens of other languages besides. This situation makes the keeping track problem harder, although perhaps it isn't fatal to it. What is fatal to it is that in other ways there aren't enough names. Often a single common name refers to many creatures, either because non-specialists don't recognize the subtle traits that separate a group of similar species, or because the same name gets applied to different organisms by different people in different places. A robin is an entirely different bird in Europe and North America, for example. And the same confusion exists for blackbirds and badgers. A fruit fly can be any of several thousand species in at least two fly families, and a daisy can be almost anything. Worst of all, many species lack any common name at all. For example, the great majority of worms and insects. How are we to talk about these species at all? Attempts to name organisms and to list them systematically are ancient. We have Babylonian clay tablets from 612 BC listing and naming about 200 species of medicinal plants. A Chinese text, the Divine Farmer's Materia Medica, listing 365 species, was likely written in about AD 250, but codifies oral traditions as much as 3,000 years older. Aristotle and Theophrastus in ancient Greece, circa 300 BC, and Dioscorides and Pliny the Elder in ancient Rome, circa AD 50, named hundreds of animals and plants, and many of their names survive today. The list of known species that early scholars had to tackle were manageable, though. By the 1600s, the strain was beginning to show, as treatises began to appear covering thousands of species. Gaspard Boin's Illustrated Exposition of Plants, 1623, covered 6,000 species, and John Ray's Historia Plantarum, 1686, covered more than 18,000. These early modern works assigned Latin names that seem much like our modern practice, except that many of them are very long. Boin, for example, named one species of asphodel, Asphodelus foliis fistulosus, or the asphodel with tubular leaves, and another Asphodelus purpurescens foliis masculatis, roughly the asphodel with leaves stained purple. These had nothing, though, on the name Pater Artedi bestowed, in 1738, on the English whiting, a fish, now Merlangius merlangus. Gadus, dorso tripterigio, ore serrato, longitudine ad latitudinem tripla, pina anni prima officulorum trigiata. Why such unwieldy names? Because the names were being asked to serve two functions at once, naming species and describing them, and the descriptions were expected to distinguish the named species from their relatives. The problem is that the more species were listed, the more cumbersome the descriptive names had to be. Perhaps worse, the discovery of new species would require adjustments to older names, so that each species' name continued to distinguish it from other similar ones. Even in the 17th century, the names as descriptions system was creaking under the weight of known biodiversity. But it was obvious that it was only going to get worse. It was the great Swedish naturalist Carl Linnaeus who solved the problem. Linnaeus's innovation was to separate the two functions of naming, to make a species name merely an identifying label which can be used to look up the description and anything else about it in the literature. Actually, that wasn't quite what Linnaeus thought he was doing. He thought of himself as giving each species two names, a short label and a longer descriptive name, like the given examples of Boin's. But before long, it became obvious that it was the short labels people would adopt as names. Those names were used as indexers to the descriptions, which were long and technical and which nobody was likely to memorize, trot out during a walk in the woods, or accommodate in their writing. Linnaeus's system of names as labels is the one we still use today. Freed by Linnaeus from the yoke of description, Latin names could be short but still unique. Linnaeus's short names were what we now recognize as binomials, with each species having a genus name and a species name of one word each. A genus is just a group of similar and, as we now know, evolutionarily related species. For example, Homo sapiens, our own species, belongs to the genus Homo, and within that genus were the species sapiens. We're the only living member of Homo, but our extinct relatives include Homo erectus, Homo neanderthalensis, Homo naledi, and so on. Notice that among these names, sapiens, which means wise, and erectus, are arguably descriptive, but they aren't what Linnaeus would have thought of as descriptive names, because they aren't precise enough to separate the named species from their relatives. Neanderthalensis and naledi aren't descriptive of their species at all. Both refer to the locations of early fossil discoveries in Germany's Neanderthal region and in South Africa's Rising Star Cave. Naledi means star in the Soto language. But names like Homo sapiens are short enough to remember and use in writing and speech, while being precise enough to mean the same thing to everyone everywhere. Binomial Latin names are the most familiar, but it's worth noting that many organisms bear names that recognize finer divisions below the species, and thus their names become trinomials. For example, the burrowing owl, Atinae cunicularia, ranges through much of the New World, and all individuals across its range bear that binomial name. However, burrowing owls in Florida differ in plumage from those across western North America, and this is recognized with subspecies names. Atinae cunicularia floridana for the Florida birds, and Atinae cunicularia hippogaea for western ones. Another 20 subspecies have been named from the Caribbean and South America, although there are debates about the validity of some of them. Subspecies tend to be recognized and named when variation within a species is structured geographically. When Western individuals differ from Eastern, island individuals from mainland, and so forth. Other patterns of variation are sometimes recognized with named varieties, subvarieties, and forms with obvious potential for complexity. Subspecies and other trinomial names are used heavily in some groups of organisms, birds and butterflies, for example, and hardly at all in others, and one could be forgiven for considering them a messy complication. That they are, but they're a messy complication that's very important to what we think a species is. In Linnaeus's time, each species was held to have been specially created by God, and to have been unchanging since its creation. Subspecies names didn't make sense in this context. If two distinct forms had been created, they'd be two species with separate names. But the revolution that followed Charles Darwin's publication in 1859 of On the Origin of Species led scientists to think completely differently. Subspecies and other sorts of variation below the species level were now evidence for the mutability of species. The Florida burrowing owl could be understood as an isolated population in the process of evolving as a new species, distinct from its ancestor and from its sister western burrowing owl. A flurry of trinomial naming in the latter half of the 19th century resulted as scientists rushed to document geographic variation as evidence for Darwin's new ideas. Etymologically, though, trinomials aren't much different from the binomials they supplement. And so, for the remainder of this book, we can afford to gloss over the distinction between a species name and a subspecies one. By freeing names from the necessity of description, Linnaeus's invention of the Latin binomial opened the door to much more creativity in naming. Descriptive names had been heavily weighted to features such as morphology. The hollow-stemmed asphodel, Asphodelus fistulosus, with fistula, Latin for a hollow reed, or color, the European fire ant, Myrmica rubra, which is reddish. Beginning with Linnaeus, names could refer to almost anything, and we'll hear in the next chapter how scientific naming works that they do. The key to the book you're listening to now is that Linnaeus opened the door to eponymous naming. He took advantage of the open door, too, naming species after earlier botanists and zoologists. For instance, black-eyed Susan, Rudbeckia, after Olaf Rudbeck, after his patrons, Henna, Lawsonia, after Isaac Lawson, who bankrolled publication of Linnaeus's masterwork, Systema Naturae, and even, in a way, after himself. Twinflower, Linnaea borealis. By making names shorter, Linnaeus freed us to make more of them, and to make them more creatively. And while it wasn't Linnaeus's goal, that creativity gives us a window on the culture of science and the personality of scientists. Through the names we give species, we can see science as an indelibly human endeavor. Linnaeus never knew just how big an advance his new naming system was, because he had no idea just how many species there were to be named. He thought there might be 10,000 plant species on Earth, but about 350,000 have been named so far, and his estimates of diversity for other groups were probably even further off. We now know that we need names in the thousands and tens of thousands, and eventually in the millions. That need for names presents scientists with a chore, to be sure, but also with an opportunity. Chapter 2. How Scientific Naming Works. Species need names, but how do they acquire them? The short answer is that the person who discovers a new species has the privilege of assigning a name to it. Two parts of that short answer need a little further explanation, though. First, what does it mean to discover a new species? Second, how is a name actually assigned? Discovering a new species sounds both simple and romantic. An intrepid explorer pushing through an uncharted rainforest swings a machete and through a newly made gap in the lianas sees a stunning scarlet flower utterly unlike any species previously known to science. Our explorer seizes the flower and the plant that produced it and heads triumphantly home to proclaim the news and bask in the resulting fame. And sometimes it really does happen that way, but it's usually a bit more complicated. Although recognizing that a plant or animal specimen belongs to a species so far unknown to science sounds straightforward, it can actually be quite difficult. That's mostly a result of evolution's incredible ability to produce variations on a theme. That 1.5 million species have been named so far probably makes it obvious that no individual human can possibly recognize them all. Many of us, of course, know a fair bit about particular groups. Birds, perhaps, or ferns, or jewel beetles. Imagine that the jewel beetles are your group and you've just picked up a small, slender, metallic beetle that you're quite sure belongs to the genus Agrilis. Is it an Agrilis species we already know, or a new one? There are over 3,000 species of Agrilis known so far, and some of them differ in ways that are quite subtle and require considerable technical knowledge to recognize. Your next move, then, is probably to ask an Agrilis expert. Such experts do fortunately exist, because a number of Agrilis species are economically important. Among them, Agrilis planipennis, the emerald ash borer, which is currently devastating ash trees across much of North America. Your Agrilis expert probably can't recognize all 3,000 species on site either, but knows which books and journal articles to consult. It may take hours or days to work through the literature, but once you've finished, imagine that your beetle doesn't quite match the published description of any of the known Agrilis. Have you discovered a new species? Well, maybe, but maybe not. In every species, individuals vary, and the degree of difference that should convince you that your Agrilis specimen represents a new species rather than an oddball may be far from obvious. Is your specimen just a largish Agrilis abditus? A smallish Agrilis abductus? A flattish Agrilis abhai? A greenish Agrilis absonus? Or a slightly aberrant Agrilis aberrans? It's not the observable differences that define a species anyway, or at least not directly. Instead, a species is, with complications that could fill several books, a set of individuals that have the potential to exchange genes by mating. Differences among individuals help us recognize barriers to gene flow, but they don't map one-to-one onto those barriers. Sometimes an oddball is just an oddball, bigger or smaller or flatter or greener than its friends as a result of a chance combination of genes or the influence of the environment in which it lived. In a particular group, certain morphological characters may be more reliable indicators of species status, and experts usually know which characteristics they are. Perhaps the numbers and locations of bristles have proven reliable in the past, but color hasn't. In insects, the shapes of the genitalia are very often the most reliable characters, so your unknown Agrilis specimen may have some uncomfortably close inspection in its future. It usually helps to have not just one specimen, but many, as species status is more likely when differences are discontinuous. That is, when there's variation within each of two species, but without overlap between them. Finally, in the last couple of decades, DNA sequence data have proven extremely useful in testing species status, even turning up new distinct species in the absence of any physical differences at all. No single indicator alone, though, is perfectly reliable, and the complexities of evolution are such that doubt often remains. For that reason, a claim that your Agrilis is a new species will always be your best guess, or, put more scientifically, a hypothesis that can be tested or disputed by other experts in the future. Sometimes the evidence for your new species hypothesis will be very strong. Sometimes it may be weaker. Sometimes, in fact, it may be very weak. Take, for example, a European species of freshwater mussel called the swan mussel, Anodonta cygnus. More than 500 times, someone has formally described a new species of Anodonta, only to have their specimens turn out to belong to A. cygnus after all. The 500 names conferred on these illusory, not actually new species are now synonyms of Anodonta cygnus, about which more to come. It turns out that freshwater mussels are notoriously variable, developing shells of different shapes on hard bottoms versus soft ones, in rapid flow versus slower, and so on. Essentially, it's very easy to find an oddball mussel. There was, to make this worse, a certain 19th century enthusiasm for naming new mussels based on very subtle distinctions. Not just the real oddballs, but the only slightly eccentric. Mussel biologists are still clearing up the resulting mess, and fortunately, it's since become conventional to hold new species hypotheses to a stricter standard. All this complexity explains why new species aren't usually discovered in the field, with or without a swinging machete. Instead, most are discovered and described from specimens in the laboratory or in a museum collection, often long after their collection from the wild. There, a biologist can compare specimens to those of previously described species, dissect tiny parts such as insect genitalia, extract and sequence DNA, and consult 3 centuries' worth of taxonomic literature. Museum collections are especially important here. In part, their role is to hold a field-collected specimen for later study, upon which it may prove to be a new species requiring description and naming. But studying a single specimen in isolation isn't likely to be informative, and so it's even more critical that museums hold large collections with many specimens of many different species, showing not just the diversity of species, but variation within each. It's by reference to these large collections that a scientist can make the comparisons needed to achieve 2 important things. First, it's based on comparisons with collections that a species can be recognized as new, as truly distinct from all the world's previously named species. Second, comparisons with collections let a new species be placed among its relatives. Perhaps it's a new member of a well-known genus, or perhaps it's something startlingly different that needs not just a new species name, but a new genus name too, or even sometimes a new family or order or class. In a sense, you can think of each new species as being discovered twice, once by someone who collects it in the field, and then a second time by someone who later recognizes its novelty and decodes its relationship to more familiar species. The 2 discoverers may sometimes be the same person, but more often they aren't. What about your agrilis beetle? If you and your agrilis expert are convinced that it represents an undescribed species, or more accurately, if you're willing to go public with the hypothesis that it does, then it needs a name. That naming is up to you, except that it has to comply with a set of rules that keep naming from descending into chaos, something that separates scientific names from common ones. Species' common names appear and evolve in the same unruly fashion as do the rest of the nouns in our languages. But formal scientific names are different. Or at least, they are now.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.